May the work I've done speak for me. May the work I've done speak for me. When I'm resting in my grave, there's nothing that can be said. May the work I've done speak for me. May the life I live speak for me.
Michael, you're an artist?
I am.
You are a performance artist?
Well, I have been.
You have been. And you're also a poet, right?
If I'm a poet,
a songwriter,
you're the only
poet.
One that thinks so.
Singer, songwriter, poet.
I don't remember that part, but I could be, I suppose.
This is what this show is about.
This is
would
about
you like
art?
To know one of your poems?
I would if I only knew any. I don't
if
know
I
any.
Only had a poem.
I,
you drew
I
that poster, the Springsteen enough. Poster, which went on to become a classic.
Well, I'm glad it did. I wish I had some of them.
And they're selling for like $5,000 each now.
I wish I saved mine.
Yes, that's true, if you can find them.
That's right. You know, Franklin doesn't have any of his old posters.
Well,
do you have any
problem.
Of your old posters?
I have a few. Invariably, the popular ones get gone because everybody that asks for one gets one. And now that they're worth some money, I don't have any.
Hello there, my old friend. Not so long ago, it was still the end. We played outside in the pouring rain. On our way up the road, we started over again. You're living our dreams, oh, you on top. My mind. That's how it's happened, living life by the drop.
I walked over to see if everything was all right. Jackson says everything's fine. She's gone. Let's go to work. And so we walked down Potrero Hill, down Arkansas Street to the bottom, and there was Ripoff Press. And he said, and I had several jobs to work on and no place to sit to do it. And he said, why don't you come sit with me in Gilbert Shelton up here? We have lots of room and you can sit up there and draw with us. And so, man, I was just in hog heaven. And we'd draw till about 6 in the evening, 7 sometimes. And Jackson would say, come on, you like to drink whiskey? I said, yes. And we'd go over to North Beach and drink all the whiskey and play all the pool and win and dance with all the girls. And 2:30 or 3 come rolling back up Potrero Hill and stand up there in the middle of the street. You could look out with all of San Francisco laid out below you and just take a whiz on the whole thing. And he said, now I'm gonna be by to get you at 9 in the morning. And I went, man, that's awful early, it's 3 now. And he goes, and this is something that always stuck with me. He said, you got to get, if you're gonna let people call you an artist, you got to get up and go draw every day. And just for a few hours, but you've got to do it every day. And no matter how late we stayed out or how messed up we might have gone, at 9 o'clock the next morning, he was blowing the horn.
Micael Priest.
Hello.
When did you first know this place even existed?
Oh, I guess just not too long after it started happening. I had spent an awful lot of time at the Vulcan Gas Company. I came down here when I was 17. Was one of the few places in the country you could get into to see music if you were that little. Spent a lot of time over there, and then when it went down, that was real sad. By that time, I was in college and had a new wife and a baby on the way. Didn't have much time to think about it until they got Captain Beefheart booked in here, and I've been a Captain Beefheart freak most of my young life, and was amazed that there was enough other weirdos in all of Texas that cared enough about Captain Beefheart to have him come here. And was pretty pleased about that, so came wandering over with my brand new, about 13-inch long baby. My son and I and my wife, and had a wonderful evening, got to meet Captain Beefheart, thought that was all pretty good. Through the course of the next couple of years, moved back to Fort Worth, that wasn't much fun. Came back down here on an offer to become the art director of an ad agency when I was 20 years old, and I said, well, that sounds pretty good, who do we got for accounts? And they said, Armadillo and Oat Willis, and I just went, okay, I'll be there tomorrow. Came wandering down here, the very first show I worked was Willie Nelson's first show in front of long-haired weirdos. And we didn't know, we were sweating that one pretty serious. We didn't know if that was gonna go at all.
This is the Vulcan Gas Company. When I first started coming here in 1969, they had no licenses of any kind. All you could get in there was a organic apple juice or a big oatmeal cookie. And the place next door, you could get a beer.
So they didn't have any alcohol?
No, they didn't have any anything.
What's your first association with this building here?
Well, I came down here with $10 and a pocket full of LSD, and I only wanted $2 a piece for them, but I was too young. I was 17, and we might need to go on to the next topic. I came here to see Poco. But the very first time I came here, I came to see Ramon and Ramon and the Four Daddios.
What year?
1969, right in September, beginning of the school year, with Hub City Movers and Shiva's Headband. I mean, I learned that you can start a dialogue at the beginning of the show if you put a little time and effort into it and actually get the act and the audience interacting with each other. Then it creates a feedback loop that spirals upward and just gets better and better.
So you people out there watching the show tonight, when you see Micael Priest, give him money.
Please.
If not money, at least his old poster's back to him.
That's right.
He helped create the
world.
If
you've got two,
live.
Give me one. I'd do the same for you.
Not the one with the pinholes in the corner.
I know, I like the ones with the pinholes. Oh, in fact, do? We've tried and tried and tried to make the collectors and the museum people understand that they were designed to be advertising. So if they have tape marks and pinholes in them, and people still have them, like that means they served their purpose and they've still been cared for and cherished, and subsequently should be worth a lot more money.
It's like a patina on a bronze statue.
Exactly, precisely correct.
There you go.
So, you were there when the armadillo was in its flower, I guess.
Yes. I suppose you could say that, and it was pretty great. It reminded me of some of my favorite underground places I'd been to in Dallas and other places, in that the front was completely nondescript, closed-down warehouse, and you drove around the back, and there was a bunch of stuff piled everywhere, and some broken cars, and some tore-down fence, and you went in what looked like an abandoned building, and here was all these hippies.
Constant stream of music and musicians through here. That's been real healthy. D. White, Guy Juke, one of our long-standing members, has also been through several musical endeavors during the time we've been up here. So a lot of times there are things set up and playing right here in the room. Everything from Joe Gracie and Bobby Earl Smith and the Jackalope Brothers to ZZ Top and Joe Ely, and there's even a white spot on the floor over there where Roy Buchanan lost his lunch up here late one night after a little bit too heavy a party. So it's historically wise, it's been a very interesting little vortex to be in.
Many years ago, he looked out through a glassless window. All that he could see was Babylon.
The important part, when I was 2 and a half, Mom gave me a pad and a pen to keep me quiet in church. And I think she thought that was going to cut down the interruption to the worship service from everybody craning over to see what I was drawing. So I told everybody that when you make your poster, remember that we're in the business of visual communication, and we would like to make posters as easy to read as the Old West wanted posters. You got to be able to read it driving 35 or 40 miles an hour with the wing vents open and a 44-ounce Diet Cherry Limeade held between your bare thighs, because you got on South Cutoff, South Austin Cutoff, which means one ball out.
I'm really worried about living. How could it come to this? Yeah, I really want to know about this. Then there came a time of kings, empires, and revolutions. Blood just looks the same. Furrowed brow has never left his face.